Random House Audio presents The Crossing, a novel by Serita Jakes, read for you by April Parker Jones with Anne Marie Lee. Part 1.
Rock of ages cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure, save from wrath and make me pure. Prologue. 10 years ago. No one prepares you for this. Parents, teachers, professors. Preachers at least try to make you aware of that final moment, just before your heart stills and breath stops. If you die tonight, will you be ready? The $2 question anyone raised in church has heard 100 times. But when the time comes, after the bullets tear into your body, while your blood spreads out across your new white shirt, and your extra-large Diet Pepsi splatters to the floor as the man holding the gun screams at the kids on the bus to shut up or they're next. Will you be ready? Now isn't the time to ask why. My body slumps to the floor like the strings holding me up have suddenly been cut. Somewhere, Claudia is crying. If she's crying, she's alive. Lord, she's 18 and searching. She's not ready for life to end. He's nudging me with his foot. I pray he doesn't check my pulse. Leave her alone! The voice of a football player coming to my defense. Don't be my hero, Cassio, I want to say. But I can't move. Can't speak. The gun fires. No, not Cassio. A few students are screaming. Most are crying, but the noise of the passing train is drowning them out. Everyone except Claudia. Chapter 1. It's strange. Since childhood, I've believed I would die in my sleep. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. In my mind's eye, I picture myself sandwiched between Mama and Daddy as we knelt beside my bed, speaking the prayer together. It always seemed like they were sucking up all the oxygen, leaving me with none. I thought I might suffocate. But I could smell Mama so well. She hadn't had her nightly bath yet, so she still smelled of southern cooking and a hint of Chanel No. 5. The smallest amount behind her ears and inside the crook of her arm was enough for it to linger wherever she wandered in the house. I loved the smell of Mama. I remember the expression on her face when she opened the box one Christmas morning. By the look of wonder, I knew she loved it. She blushed under Daddy's admiring gaze as she dabbed some on her wrist and lifted her arm to his face. As I watched, a bubble, like the ones I used to blow with those huge pieces of sugar-coated bubble gum, started deep inside me and got bigger and bigger. It was a rare moment of sheer joy in our family. A few years later, a pin of reality burst the facade. But in that moment, joy. I'm glad my mind took me back to that place, if only for a minute. I can remember Daddy as he was, and forgive what he became. And if I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take.
Present day. Claudia. Claudia hated this moment, stopped at the tracks, watching the lights flash and hearing the bell clang. First in line, as the wall forms in front of her, the whistle growing louder as the engine nears. The rhythm of steel against steel, the train racing by, beating in her ears. Other cars had lined up behind her, hedging her in, suffocating, blocking any chance of escape. Could a heart really pound right out of its chest? She felt her breath coming in short bursts. Her phone beeped, but she couldn't bring herself to look for it. Closing her eyes tight, she gripped the steering wheel. Her chest hurt, and she could smell the metallic tang of blood. The rest of her senses picked up the sensation. She could taste the iron way back in her throat, and her ears pounded with the rhythm of her heartbeat. Then her hands felt a sticky warmth. BJ's blood soaking her cheerleading skirt. The wetness spread over her legs. She gasped and stared down at her lap. Her Diet Coke had spilled on her light tan linen pants. Still, she couldn't move. No matter that the train had come and gone, still she sat, staring at the bare metal tracks. Her body shook all over. Vehicles sped around her, blaring their horns. People glared at her, some even shouting obscenities at her. But it was no use. She'd become paralyzed. She didn't know how many minutes she sat there while the world swept by her, a still body in a raging storm. A dull tap registered in her brain. She turned toward the sound and tried to focus on the man outside her window. He reached out and made another clipped, three-rap knock on the glass. Finally, recognition flashed, trying to convince her that everything was okay. She pressed the button and lowered the window for the waiting police officer. Claudia. His voice sent a shiver down her spine. Images sped through her mind, blurring her focus. Is there something wrong with your car? His voice was a little deeper now than it had been 10 years ago, but she could still hear it screaming. Leave her alone! And then the gunshot. She could feel herself fading again. Claude. He reached in through the window and shook her shoulder. Come on, girl. I know what this is. I've been there too. But snap out of it. You're in the middle of the street. She felt herself slowly ascending, as though swimming from the bottom of a deep lake. At the surface, a ragged, cold breath filled her lungs. Cassio. Tears filled her eyes. It's okay, baby, he said, his voice soft, taking her back to the days when he was quarterback, she was cheerleader, and everyone said they'd be America's sweethearts. Can you drive the car into the parking lot? He pointed to the right where a mom-and-pop cafe sat practically empty. She nodded. I'll be right behind you. It took every ounce of willpower to slide the Tahoe into gear and drive toward the parking lot. Once she stopped, her lungs screamed, and she could feel the breath-stealing, muscle-seizing horror of hyperventilation coming on. Cassio appeared at the passenger side door. Clutching her chest, she pointed toward the glove box. Bag, she managed to gasp. What? A bag. In there. Oh, okay. Are you okay? Hang on. Cassio opened the glove box and pulled out a paper bag, then brought it to her mouth. Breathe. In. Out. In. Out. She did. Her lungs felt like they might burst as the panic spiked. Oh, God, it's just like that night. A scream vibrated in her throat, and she squelched it before it could pierce the air inside the Tahoe. No. Cassio's hand pressed against her clammy neck. Now listen, Claude. Keep breathing. His smooth as silk tone calmed her and evened out her breath. She tried to focus on his tone. This isn't like that night on the bus. No one is after you. The person with a gun was after BJ. no one else. It wasn't a random act, or I wouldn't have just been shot in the arm, right? If that man was on a killing spree, we'd all be dead right now. His voice was beginning to soothe her, and slowly the words sank into her muddled brain. She set the bag in her lap and filled her lungs with the cleansing breath. "Thanks, Cassio," she whispered and tried to smile. "You're a hero." His jaw clenched as he inhaled from a freshly lit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.